This spike we place right in next to the dorsal fin. That's the pinger.
And if you put it on that bone behind your ear, you can hear it pinging.
Oh man! Oh! It's quite high pitched. It sounds like a really high pitched bird chirping in your ear.
The sound given off by the tag, they're all on a frequency of 69 kilohertz, but then each tag has its own specific frequency space ID.
So using underwater microphones, you can hear when different sharks are nearby.
There's a little yellow buoy out there which actually has a little tracker on it, so every time a tagged shark swims by,
it's just like the shark checking in.
Yeah, it is. It is like the shark checking in. And over here at the Neptune's, we're lucky enough that it connects to a satellite.
And emails us, lets us know.
At home, when the shark is here.
And at the same time, we also hope to get a tissue sample from the shark that we tag.
Why is that important to grab a tissue sample?
A couple of studies we're doing are looking at the genetic populations of the different sharks of the world. And even in Australia, we're finding there's two different genetic populations. Also, we can work out what the shark's been eating recently by its tissue.
Wow. But before you can tag a shark, you have to entice it close to the boat.
Well, it's morning and we're just about to have breakfast, but I thought I'd come out and have a look at the shark's breakfast. Yeah. That is what we're going to be leeching overboard to attract the sharks to our cages.
We just threw the bait in and waited about 2 minutes and a shark came up and grabbed it. I was trying to film the seagulls around the bait when it hit. It was incredible, just unbelievable to see how fast they arrived here. So the sharks are here and they're biting.
The goal is not to feed the sharks, but to pull the bait away from them before they can get it.
Oh man! That's a big shark.
As a storm rolled in, it was my chance to observe the sharks on their own terms, underwater.
I'm just trying to make a nice seal with my mask so I don't get any water in. That means heaps of Vaseline on my mustache. Feels disgusting.
Today we've got pretty stormy weather and the sharks are fired up a bit. This is the weather that suits them for predation with the sea lions.
Not so good for us, we're all cold and wet, but yeah, good conditions for sharks.
That's thicker, awesome. Even thicker. Yeah.
This is gross. Yeah. It's got, you're using like half the tub on me.
Yeah, that's how it's got to be.
Have fun.
Thank you.
When the storm front coming through is the best. Sharks will fire up for you.
Thank you.
From the cage, you can see the sharks that have already been tagged. And you get a different perspective on what it's like to pull food away from a shark's mouth. In real time, you can see just how fast they can strike.
That was a pretty incredible, surreal experience. Just you drop in there and it's a whole another world. And it's funny, you don't really feel scared of them, just, I don't know, maybe it's the cage, but you know, they just look so docile and peaceful. So how hard is it to stick one of those in the dorsal fin?
Now, if I can get a shark in really close and get the right shot, they make it pretty easy when they swim past the back of the platform here.
There it is. Oof.
Yeah, it has to be going, slightly going away, it has to totally present itself.
It's coming up. Come on.
Oh, so close.
Come on.
So close.
It's
actually nice. With the light fading, tagging was put on hold until tomorrow. And that gave me a chance to talk to the researchers about why this research is so important.
Before protection, they were hunted for sport. They were hunted for their jaws, And they were hunted just out of fear.
Everybody was scared of sharks.
You know, the Jaws movie, the Jaws phenomenon, it created an awful lot of fear of these animals.
Sharks were mindless killers.
And people just wanted them out of the ocean. Population numbers basically crashed.
And this research is essential to help their numbers recover.
We have to find out how many sharks are out there. We have to find out where they travel to, where they breed. That's one of the holy grails that no one knows. Where do they give birth? We don't know that either. No one's ever seen them breeding. No one's ever seen them giving birth. And if you can't protect sharks in those key areas, then you're not going to really be able to have much of an impact across the population as a whole.
Looking good, guys. Looking good.
You know, we've begun to scratch the surface with satellite tagging. We always thought white sharks were a coastal species. We found that they're able to do dives well over a kilometer deep. They frequently dive off the edge of the continental shelf. They go and inhabit niches out in the open ocean for months and months and months on end. Yeah. So this whole myth that they are this coastal creature has been completely debunked with the advent of this new technology. It's one of those things with these animals that if you ask a question and you conduct your research and you answer your question, and then you have five more questions that have arisen from that answer. So there's a lot more to learn.
Veritasium is supported by Audible.com, a leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles in all areas of literature, including fiction, nonfiction, and periodicals. This week I wanted to recommend a book called Genius, The Life and Science of Richard Feynman by James Gleick. He is one of my all-time favorite authors, so you should really check it out. In fact, you can download it for free by going to audible.com/veritasium, or you can pick any other book of your choice for a one-month free trial. So thank you to Audible.com for supporting me. Now, if you don't know, I also have a second channel which is called To Veritasium, where I post vlogs and my thoughts on the world. So if you want to check that out, then you can click on this link or the link in the description. So thank you for watching. I will see you next time.